certain, never reaching the end. Letters I've written, never meaning to send. Beauty I've always been, with these eyes before. Truth is, I can't say anymore. If I love you,
welcome back, yeah. And welcome to that moodiest of moody blues, Justin Hayward. Really nice to see you, Justin. It's funny, you've done that so many times, that number at concerts. We were just sitting here watching it, and you were saying, oh, where in the world was that done, and when?
Yeah,
we pinned it down to about 85, 1985.
That's right, yeah. Saturday Night Live, 85.
I mean, Nights in White, I mean, that's part of my past, that song. I mean, it's a major part of your past, isn't it? One of the, so
absolutely,
But it's also, I mean, I remember that. Was it 1967 or
Yes,
eight?
1967
67.
It first came out, that's right. As part of an album.
And I was suffering. I had a broken engagement when I was at university. And I sat and listened to that.
Me too.
I sat and listened to that.
Did you?
Yeah. Oh, I wish we'd known. Anyway, I sat and listened to that all summer and sort of sobbed into my coffee. But I was astonished even though sort of researching this interview. Yes, I know, I was pathetic. Well, I was very young.
I know, it means a lot, just to complete that. It means a lot to so many people, and that's the wonderful thing about that song. It's a great thing to be able to share.
Yeah.
Kind of doesn't belong to me, really, anymore.
It is strange, isn't it? Noel Coward or somebody said that, you know, the potency of certain kinds of music. I mean, there are certain numbers, you know, in all our pasts, which can evoke all kinds of emotions.
Yeah,
you
sure.
Know?
I feel exactly. A lot of Beatles records do that for me, you know, from the early 60s.
Hmm.
And particularly the Hard Day's Night album. Any song off that album, I can. Yeah. It puts me right back in a place and a time with people. And
what about your own music? Is that sort of associated with hard work to you, so you don't feel quite the same emotional
pull?
Well,
they're like. Your own songs are like a diary of your own life, and you can look back over sort of all. For me, my solo albums and the Moody Blues albums, and I can see what I was going through emotionally and sort of even spiritually a lot of the time during the making of those albums.
When you actually record, there was a point in time, wasn't there? There was a point in time, sometime in, I don't know, late 66, early 67, when that number had been recorded. It was on the master track, but no one had heard it yet. You know?
No.
But you had, you'd written it, you'd sung it. Do you know when you've written a cracker? Do you get a feeling, a buzz?
No, because I've been wrong so many times, I'm the last person, you know, to ask. But we did know, we actually recorded it a long time before we made the record. We recorded it for, and with a few other numbers, for the BBC. Mm. And the first time we ever heard it, we were going, this is Nights, the first time we ever heard Nights, we were in a van coming up the M1. In our transit van, it was on the radio, it was on like Easy Beat or Saturday Club, one of those old shows. And so we were listening to it back and we thought, yeah, this is really good. And by the time we'd got to the end of the journey, to the gig that we were playing at, we'd convinced ourselves that we'd never ever be able to do it any better. There was something magic about that recording that we could never recapture.
Yeah.
So we phoned up the radio company and we said, have you still got that tape? They said, oh no, you know, as soon as it's broadcast, we re-record over it.
Oh.
And it's gone. And then we went through hell, you know, for like a few months until we actually went in the studio to record it properly. And it was great. It's just the same.
Yeah. And 25 years with the Moody Blues, and you're all still friends. I mean, that's astonishing.
Sure, yeah.
Still get along together. No great major splits. Well, you did have one split, didn't you?
We kind of drifted apart in the 70s for about 3 years, It's the best thing we ever did, actually, looking back.
Why?
I thought we were crazy at the time because we'd just really reached a peak, you know, of success. Because there was nowhere else to go, and we'd really grown up together. We, you know, Nights was done when we were kids, really. So I was 19 years old. So we'd just grown up together. We knew what the other guy was going to say before he even said it. And
I suppose because of the phenomenal success in touring the world, I mean, you were in that little crucible, you know, which no one
else
could get into.
Smaller.
And all you had, the only people you could talk to were each other, really.
That's right.
So protected from the outside
world. We got to the stage where we had private everything, you know, private cars, private rooms, private planes.
You had a 747, didn't you? Private 747.
We had a 707.
707.
It was, Starship One,
So since then, I mean, you're all still together. You're still an enormous success. I mean, it's still an enormous success in America as well, which is where
you
sell a lot of records.
Yeah, that's been our market, yeah.
But, I mean, have you got used to the ordinary world again? I mean, do you yourself, I know you've got a wife and a daughter, I mean, do you live a fairly ordinary,
Absolutely.
Normal life with your family?
Because the Moody Blues is almost a kind of faceless thing, and it's only people who really know and are interested in the Moody Blues music that ever know who you are, you know? If ever I get recognised, say, I mean, you must get recognised, you can't escape from, because you're on TV every day, but all people ever say to me, really, or some people, is, oh, you're, who are you? Your thing from the What's It.
Your thing from the What's It, yeah. Well, listen, I mean, I'm afraid that Justin's career is about to take a sharp nosedive later in the programme, because we're going to do a number together, aren't we?
Yes, it's going to be great.
You're going to sing and play, and I'm just going to play wrong chords.
This is the point where Richard becomes a supergroup and gets a private plane. Along with Justin.
Somebody will be watching, Svengali.
I look forward to it. It's lovely to see you.
Okay, from supergroups like the Moodies to, another superhero. Is it a bird? Is it a plane? I'm afraid not. It's a Brian. The poster said, you'd believe a man could fly, and that's exactly what our Hollywood reporter Brian Thomas did when Superman Christopher Reeve said that he'd give him an interview.